Welcome to Platts Commodity Pulse. I'm Richard Swann, Managing Editor of Oil News in Europe, the Middle East and Africa. Political instability in the key oil-producing areas of the Middle East and North Africa has been a near constant backdrop to the high and volatile oil prices we have seen for most of this year. As the civil war in Libya seemingly nears an end, the oil market is now waiting to see when the country's high-quality crude exports will resume. And as one restart looms, the oil sector of another oil producer, Syria, has been hit with sanctions by the European Union and the US. Joining me today to analyse recent events in both countries are Platts senior correspondent Margaret McQuaile and Tim Worledge, head of our Middle Distillates team in London. Good morning. I'd like to start with Libya, I think. We know Libya is a huge oil sector in Africa. It's Africa's biggest holder of oil reserves, a significant producer. But we saw production fall to near zero and exports pretty much to zero since the uprising against the regime of Muammar Gaddafi started in February this year. Who's been hardest hit by this?
Europe, and specifically the Mediterranean. Libya was producing about 1.6 million barrels a day of crude before the uprising. That volume has steadily fallen, and now it's negligible. And about 1.3 million barrels a day, roughly, was being exported pretty much to Europe, Italy, France, Germany, Spain. And it's good quality stuff, so there was an impact.
Right. Tim, it's not just the crude, there's also a refined products angle with Libya, isn't there?
Yeah, and there were alternatives that were offered by other countries as well to the loss of the Libyan crude. Saudi Arabia stepped up a special blend that was aimed at trying to kind of bridge the gap left by Libyan output. But there really wasn't an awful lot of appetite for that. One of the main beneficiaries of the loss of Libyan crude seems to have been Azeri Light coming through the Turkish port of Ceyhan. And that seems to be geographically, it's not far removed from Libya, so a lot of refiners have turned to that. But there hasn't really been a huge upsurge in the sort of price indicators that we'd be looking for in the Mediterranean as refiners or indeed demand centres are crying out for starved fuels. So we haven't really seen a big pickup, and it still seems to link back to the fact that Europe itself is not really the force it once was. I mean, two or three years ago, Europe was pulling in middle distillates from all over the world. Today, it still imports an awful lot more to meet its needs, but the demand that we have seen in the past is still really struggling under the impact of the economic slowdown. And until that really clears, no good time for this sort of thing to happen, but Libya hasn't perhaps had the sort of impact on the product markets that you'd expect.
As well as being a significant export of crude, of course, Libya actually imports some refined products to cover its own needs. Is that
right? That's correct, yeah. A lot of gas oil. I mean, it does have some fairly well-developed, well-advanced refining capacity, particularly around Ras Lanuf, towards the sort of centre of the country. But it does import a lot of its gasoline, particularly its finished gasoline, and also its gas oil to provide agricultural needs, motoring needs, industrial needs. So it imports something in the region of four or five cargoes of gas oil a month, or it has imported. That hasn't been there, but also at the same time it also exports some products. Ras Lanuf itself will export something like six jet cargoes a month. And that is something that has been missed because it exports it on a very specific cargo size, and it's a cargo size that naturally lends itself to the Mediterranean market. So those sort of areas that need that cargo size have been starved a little bit of that supply. But
Back in the upstream sector, we know that the international oil companies play a key role in Libya. Companies from a wide array of countries operate a lot of Libyan oil production. They pretty much all pulled out the expatriate staff earlier this year when the uprising started, since when operations have been pretty dormant at most of the fields. Not all, but most. What's the latest there, Margaret?
Well, the latest is that these companies are looking at their operations. They're trying to assess what the state is of the various facilities. There is no timetable at the moment for the return of expat staff, and that's an important issue because Libya has depended very much on these expat workers. They have their own workers as well, but so much of the work on Libya's upstream is done by expat people.
And we there's been a lot of sort of confidence about the end of the regime, the fall, the end of the approaching end of the conflict. But I think we're still a long way from seeing a real final end to the actual fighting and the situation in general. I think the most recent precedent we have, I suppose, is to look at what happened in Iraq. And the immediate fall of Saddam Hussein there, it led to a lot of infighting between the tribes, a lot of power struggling, and there was a good few months before we actually even tracked down Hussein. There we had, I suppose, the advantage of nearly a quarter of a million US and British troops looking for him. We don't have that situation in Libya. Libya is a big country. Gaddafi is still missing. We're getting reports of his family starting to maybe disappear and crop up in other African countries, but Gaddafi himself is still missing and still carries a lot of support. There are still factions that are fighting for him. And without a real proper assessment of what state the infrastructure is in, the pipelines are in, the pipelines, the refineries are in, it's very difficult to say, I think, with any degree of certainty that we're actually approaching anywhere near a resumption of Libyan crude supplies. I think also you have to, even when we're at that point where the pipelines are reconnected and oil is starting to flow again, as long as Gaddafi is out there and Gaddafi's supporters are out there, we always the risk of this sort of guerrilla war that is being waged, and pipelines are very long, difficult to guard facilities. Mm. So there is a certain amount of vulnerability here still, and I think that's something that will continue to haunt the activity in Libya for a while.
Yeah, that's a very sobering parallel you draw there with Iraq. Of course, with Libya, I think it's important we recognise that what's happened in Libya hasn't happened in isolation.
Yeah.
We've had the Arab Spring across a number of countries. It just so happens that Libya has been the biggest oil producer to have had events of that magnitude happen. But I do want to talk a little bit today about Syria, where a similar kind of process has happened, if you like. The feeling in the streets has turned against the regime of President Assad, and the situation has got very ugly in recent weeks. Mm. It's not as significant to the oil market perhaps as Libya, but nonetheless it's one to watch.
Yeah, we've got about 150,000 barrels a day of Syrian supply not reaching Europe. And it's not a huge volume when you think of world oil supply in general, but it's still a chunk of supply that isn't getting where it normally gets.
And this is a result, there are now sanctions from both the European Union and the United States against Syria. They're slightly different though.
Yeah, they're different. The US sanctions basically bar any US citizen from having any dealings with the Syrian oil sector. So that's one set of sanctions. The European sanctions, and I would say here, the US doesn't actually import very much Syrian oil. It's negligible. Europe, on the other hand, has banned the import of Syrian oil. It has banned the transport and purchase of Syrian oil.
Okay. Tim, again, Syria, as Margaret's talked about, there's a substantial chunk of crude exports here, but it's quite a regular player in the product markets.
It is. It certainly exports naphtha out of Banias, and it does import a substantial volume of gas oil as well. Middle distillates, again, the key there. It's not a massive consumer. It's not one that's going to change the balance of things in the Mediterranean, but we have seen recently it's in this sort of halfway house where it's almost functioning as normal. Despite the sanctions. So we have seen some buy tenders issued recently for gas oil where it's trying to bring product into the country, and we've seen a lot of traders who are saying either they flat outright can't touch those tenders, they can't go in for them. We've also seen other trading houses that are perhaps not bound by the sort of sanctions. They're also saying we can't go into it, we just can't risk it because we don't want to alienate some of the big powers that are affected by sanctions, and we don't want to run the risk of not being paid, basically. So there are, although on one level it's trying to function as normal, on another level it's very much being affected by these sanctions in almost by proxy.
And yet these European sanctions don't actually ban the supply of refined products to Syria, but as Tim is saying, there is a certain level of concern.
So it's de facto. The sanctions are applied even amongst the elements that are not bound by those sanctions are still affected by them.
Interesting. Mm. I want to talk a bit about the impact of all this unrest in what is clearly a key area for oil production exports, even if Syria itself is not the biggest, on oil prices. Mm. this year we've had very sustained high oil prices, despite non-stop, it seems, economic gloom, certainly from across the developed world. The economic situation is poor and deteriorating in many countries, and yet we've got these high oil prices. Early this year, when we had the Libyan uprising started, we'd already had the Egyptian revolution. We had unrest in Bahrain. There was a lot of fear in the market, and to some extent, you could see how that fear was supporting a high oil price scenario. Several months on, the Libyan conflict seemingly nearing an end, although, as you said, we're not going to call an end to that one yet. And there has been, with the exception of Syria, mercifully few other sort of similar events happening in other countries. Why are the oil prices still high? Is there still a fear factor in there, Tim?
Well, evidently, yes. I mean, that's part of it. But you're right. I mean, we're looking at a whole range of factors. In fact, crude was already creeping back towards $100 a barrel before the Arab Spring really kicked off. And that was on the basis of some evidence that China was still, well, it's clearly still growing. There is still demand out there. There are still markets that are growing and therefore have a big appetite for oil. But Europe and North America have been these kind of strange halfway houses again, where they're showing the odd sign that people will take as good news, that the economies are getting better. But as soon as crude starts creeping up again, and we've seen it actually reach, I think, somewhere in the mid-$120 a barrel this year, not the headline-grabbing heights that we saw two, three years ago in 2008 when it made $147 a barrel. But the net impact is that, in fact, the gradual increase in crude prices is actually taking 2011 to the highest average oil price that we've ever seen. And economies themselves, there are still big question marks over whether North America and Europe can support those kind of oil prices as it gets to 120, 125.
I think one of the key variable, perhaps economic conditions notwithstanding, seems to be Libya here. We've got very high quality crude exports, a significant volume, was it about 1.3 million barrels a day of exports, and it's off the market. Now, the war's nearly over. The rebels sort of have control, we think, of most of the oil facilities in the country. We don't yet know the status of them. How realistic is it to start thinking about when we're going to get the oil back on the market?
It's so hard to say. You've got all these different predictions. For example, a few weeks ago, Wood Mackenzie predicted it would take 3 years to get Libya back to full capacity. It was producing 1.6 million barrels a day before the uprising. We had the head of the Libyan National Oil Corporation the other day saying 800,000 to a million barrels a day within 6 months.
6 months versus 3 years?
Yeah. That's 800 to a million. It's not the full 1.6. Then we had the same head of NOC saying over the weekend that with the help of you know, the foreign oil companies, all sorts of, you know, EOR and so on, that you could have maybe 2.5 by 2015, 2.5 million barrels a day. Who knows? Tim, I think you were talking about security issues. I would imagine security will be a huge concern.
Yeah, I think you're right. I think it's by no means a question of war over, oil restarts.
No.
All right. Well, thank you both very much for joining me today to talk about this. We could go on for a lot more, but I'm afraid that's our time for today. So that's all for this edition of Platts Commodity Pulse.